Hello, Namaste, hope all of you are doing good. Welcome to the lecture 6 of Strength of Materials part 1. Now in earlier session we have concluded that there is something called stress system and which we can represent by a matrix like sigma ij, which when we expand that matrix we will get something like this. Here what there we have also discussed that instead of sigma xy we can write it as tau xy. That means what I meant to say, when I is equal to j, instead of writing it sigma I or sigma jj, we can simply write it as sigma I. That means instead of whenever sigma xx is there, we can simply write it as sigma x. For sigma yy, we can simply write it as sigma y. So in that way, we have studied there. In similar way, when I is not equal to j, we have told that instead of writing sigma ij, we can write it as tau ij. That means when I have, say for example, sigma xy, I can write it as tau xy, because generally tau is the notation that is used for shear stresses. These are the shear stresses. Whenever I is not equal to j, that is representing a shear stress. When I equal to j, it is representing normal stress. These are the diagonal elements, sigma xx, sigma yy, sigma zz. All the other are representing shear stresses. These things we have studied earlier, right? Now we have also concluded there that this will be a symmetric matrix. How it is a symmetric matrix, that we will discuss in this session. Before going there, we have to know that there is something called complementary shear concept, complementary shear stress concept. We will come to know what it is by end of this lecture. Now earlier, when I was taking an example of a bicycle, I told that there are several links in the bicycle chain. That is assembled along with the sprocket and the pedals. When we pedal it, this chain and sprocket system will help us move forward, which is connected to the wheels of the bicycle. Now, one of the components of the link is something like this. As an example, I have shown you that day. And I told you that it is generally subjected to unidirectional stresses or loads, normal loads. It is, in this case, it is tensile load. There what we have studied that in the strength of materials, in the first lecture I have told that we are concerned only about successfully functioning components. We are not at all concerned with failed components, because that study of those failed components comes under failure analysis. That is not the part of strength of materials. So whatever stresses that we are applying, whatever study we are doing for an element or a component that are within the limits of its ultimate strength or yield strength, whichever is our perspective or design concerned with. So generally we are mostly concerned with stresses below elastic limit. Okay, so within the elastic limit, so that they can regain their own shape once load is relieved. So those things we have studied earlier. Now observe. When I have said that, say there are this component, in earlier version I also told that a particular component that we take is composed of several molecules at a microscopic level, several molecules, hundreds, thousands, millions of molecules stay together. Instead of talking, this is studied at microscopic level, and this studying it as an entirety, as a link itself, is macroscopic. But to understand this concept, let us take something in between them. Say, let us take a block. Let us say that this entire link that is composed of these many molecules, I am clubbing several molecules together as cuboids, different cuboids. There are say 10 cuboids, 100 cuboids, 1000 cuboids. In that way, 1, 2, 3, 4, several cuboids are there of equal shapes. So, one such cuboid when we take, this will be something like this. On that only, in the last session, I have showed you this sigma xs, all these stress components by taking in on a Cartesian coordinate system. There I have also mentioned that in Cartesian coordinates, when we are studying stresses using Cartesian coordinate system, it is better for us to assume that the shape of this blocks is cuboid, because we can take this molecule shape as a sphere as well. But problem with taking sphere is, it is very difficult for us to study the sphere directions in Cartesian coordinate system. So it is easier for us to lay out a cuboid on a Cartesian coordinate system, and it is very easy to study its behavior in Cartesian coordinate system. So what we assume is this particular link is made up of several hundreds of such cuboids, which again are made up of several molecules within them. So we are not talking completely at microscopic level, but at a bit level above it, nearer to macroscopic level, where we say that instead of saying millions and millions of molecules, we are saying hundreds and thousands of cuboids are composing this particular link or component that we are discussing about. Now you might be clear. So on that element only we are doing all our stress analysis, right? We are taking this as a, we are talking this as a infinitesimally small or elemental volume. Now on this we are doing the stress analysis. Why we are doing on something which is so small? Because whenever I say stresses, this is not external to the element. This is not external to the component that we are talking. This is stresses are something in relation to internal forces. And what causes these internal forces? These internal forces are caused by these component, these infinitesimally small elements that compose, that come together and compose this particular link. This is called internal forces are caused by these particular infinitesimally small elements. So stress, since stresses are arising out of these internal forces, they are linked to this infinitesimally small elemental volumes, right? Okay, so whenever I am talking about stresses, I am talking about at infinitesimally small volume as well when I am trying to study theory concepts. Fine. So observe this one. So what we have here, there we have sigma x on positive x face, and opposite to that on negative x face, that is face number 4 on the right, face number 4, that is left hand face, then sigma x is in opposite direction. Similarly on top face, which is in positive y direction, for that face the sigma y is in upward direction. But negative y face, that is bottom face, that is face 5, this one, bottom face. For face 5, sigma is, y is acting downwards, opposite, equal and opposite. Same for sigma z also. One is on the positive z face, that is face number 1, sigma z is acting in positive z direction. On negative z face, that is face number, the backward face, on that sigma z is acting in negative direction, right? So as far as these stresses are considered, we have understood this is on an infinitesimally small volume dx dy dz. This one we know it is dx, this one we know it is dy, this one we know it is, sorry, this is dz, sorry, very sorry, this is dz and this will be dy. Height will be dy, along y axis dy, infinitesimally small length. Now we are missing one more thing, that is shear stresses. So in x direction, in topwards, vertically upwards, sorry, not in y direction, vertically upwards, on x face, we have something called, I am directly writing it as tau, tau x face in y direction. Here also we have tau y face in x direction. Here we have tau x face z direction. Here we will have tau z face in x direction. We will have tau z face in y direction. Here we will have tau y face in z direction, the stresses. These again, these are on three faces that I am talking, but opposite to them, same way, there are stresses on the other faces also. This is fa on face number top face 6, I have tau yz. On the bottom face also, I will have tau yz, but in opposite direction. That opposite direction, I will prove that also why it should be opposite direction. That will be tau yz in opposite direction. In the same way, tau xy on second face, I have tau xy in this direction. That is on second face. On fourth face, I will have tau xy in downward direction. So in that way, every stress I am taking on the opposite face, it will be in opposite direction. Okay. Due to that, what is happening? I said that this element, in order for this entire link to be in this entire link to be in equilibrium, every component, every element in that link should also be in equilibrium. So in that way, this element, that this finite, infinitesimally small element we are talking about, should also be under equilibrium. For that to be in equilibrium, we know sigma fx should be equal to 0, sigma fy equal to 0, sigma fz equals to 0. Now, when I say force will be again every, so whatever forces are there in x direction, I have to add. For one, I will show you, others you can calculate at your home or as an assignment. When I say sigma fx, what are all there in x direction? Stress into area will be force, right? So sigma x into face number 2, area face number 2, that will be in positive direction, plus sigma x into a2 minus sigma x into a4 due to this one. A4 again in x direction, what are there? Again tau y x is there. So plus tau y x into, it is on the top face, a6. Again on the bottom face, same tau y x will be there in the opposite direction, tau y x. So negative direction of x, right? So minus tau y x into a5. No more forces in x direction. There are in other direction, forces are there in other direction, but in x direction only these forces are there. No, there are more forces, right. So plus this tau zx, force due to tau zx, that is tau zx, it is on front face in positive x direction. So front face means a1. Similar to this, on the backward face in opposite direction, negative x direction, there will be tau zx again. So on negative, in negative direction, tau zx into a3. These are the only forces that are acting on x direction. This should be equal to, so now what is happening is a2 and a4, these are opposite faces of a cuboid, they are equal, sigma x, so this will become 0. The same way a6, a5, both are same in area because 6 is the top face, 5 is the bottom face, tau y x same, so this will cancel out. In that way, similarly, this will also cancel out. In that way, sigma fx, sigma fy, sigma fz, they will cancel out. If we have sigma x here, same and opposite stress should be here also. If I tau y x in this direction, in positive x direction, y face, on negative y face, we should have tau y x in opposite direction. So every stress component that we are seeing will, on one face, will have an opposite direction stress in another opposite face, right? So this is clear up to you, up to here, right? So fine. Now observe one more thing. When you observe from this direction, from front face, we have something like this. So again, I'm drawing clearly. So what we have understood just now is shear stresses are trying to distort that. Earlier we have studied, right? Normal stresses will not distort, they will elongate or compress. But shear stresses will distort the shape. So this one is tau yx. This one is also tau yx, but in opposite direction. These are faces 5 and this is face 6. And here I have tau xy. This is face number 2. This is face number 4. And this is tau xy again. Now, just now I told that we are neglecting normal stresses sigma x and sigma y because they are not contributing anything to the moments. So that will be 0. The moments due to those forces anyway will be 0. So we are not considering that. Now we have to consider shear stresses. About the center, when we take, these forces are either trying to rotate this block in clockwise or in anti-clockwise. Now let us see what are the forces due to each stress. On face number 2, when we say we have shear stress tau xy into A2, area 2, this face for the, this area for this face, area 2, right? And similarly for face 4, we have tau xy into A4. Now both, so this is, these are the forces, right? So let us name it as force F2 and F4. So what is happening? F4 is acting downwards and F2 is acting upwards. And also observe, both are tau xy, because from sigma fy equal to 0, we got that tau xy should be same on both the faces. So tau xy is same, tau xy is same. And A2 is equal to A4 because they are opposite faces in a cuboid. So A2 equal to, so overall, well, what we can say, F2 is equal to F4. So in this condition, when you see F2 is equal to F4, one more thing what we are seeing is they are in opposite in direction. Right? Now in this scenario, what we say is those forces contribute to couple. Now same is the case with tau yx. So this is actually giving anti-clockwise or counter-clockwise couple. Similarly, tau yx, what it is doing? Tau yx, force due to tau yx is tau yx into A6, and force due to this one, bottom one, is tau yx into A5. But again observe, tau yx and tau yx will be equal because we have already seen from sigma fx equal to 0, that equilibrium equation. Again, A6 and A5 are same because these are opposite faces of a cuboid. So here again, what we have, this can be F6 phase force, this can be F5 force, where we have F5 equal to F4. Also, they are acting in opposite direction. One is positive x direction, one is negative x direction. So same equal forces at a certain distance and acting in opposite direction. Again, they will also contribute to couple, but this time they are contributing to clockwise couple. So again, so in xy plane for moments to be 0, what we need is total clockwise couples will be equal to total counterclockwise couple. So what we actually have, tau y on this one, tau yx into A6, since both are same, this one and this one same magnitude, I can either write tau yx into A5 or also I can write it as tau yx into A6, both are same, okay? And this height is dy, we already have it. On this face again, we have tau xy into A2. Here we have tau xy into A4, and this length is dx. So moment, these opposite forces are creating some couple, right? So what are the clockwise couples, total clockwise couples we have? This tau yx into A6 into distance between those forces, that is dy. this force and this force, and distance between them is dy. Similar way, which should be equals to tau xy, I mean counterclockwise directions couple. So tau xy into a2 and tau xy into a4, both are same actually, a2 and a4 are same. So tau xy into a2, we can write it as tau xy into a2 also. So the tau xy into a2, that force into the distance between them, that is dx. Now, what is a6? Come back here. What is a6? That is sixth face, top face, right? For top face, dx is the width. Opposite face, dx is the width. And this one is dz. So dx and dz, that is the area. Dx into dz will be the area. So tau yx into dz into dx into dy, which is equals to tau xy into, what is area a2? Again, come back. Area a2, when I say second face, so this one, this is dz into the height dy, this height dy. So dz into dy will be the area a2, dz into dy into dx. Now observe here, dz dx dy, dz dy dx, overall multiplication. So it is volume by one time. So what we finally have is tau yx equals to tau xy. In similar way, when we conduct for m sigma moment yz and sigma moment zx equal to 0, those equilibrium equations, we will get other two that are tau xz equals to tau zx and tau yz equals to tau zy. So earlier we already derived tau xy equals to tau yx. So see, what are these actually? Tau xy and tau yx, what are they? On adjacent faces, this is phase 2 and this is phase 6. Tau xy is on top face, tau yx is on x axis. So they both are meeting, coming towards each other. So they are in adjacent faces 2 and 5. Also bottom face, when you see tau yx and tau, bottom face and this left side face 5 and 4, those both are also adjacent faces. So on these adjacent faces, these stresses are coming towards each other. So these stresses, we call it as a complementary stresses, and they will be equal in value. Why they will be equal? Because they need to maintain the equilibrium of the body or the element. So these is called complementary shear stresses. So tau xy is complementing tau yx, tau xz is complementing tau zx, tau yz is complementing tau zy. Their values are same. Magnitude wise, their values are same. Directions are different, but magnitude wise, their values are same. Okay, so value wise, I can substitute one for the other. For tau yz, I can substitute tau zy. For tau xz, I can substitute tau zx. For tau xy, I can substitute tau yx. So in this way, ultimately what I am having, sigma ij, I am having sigma x, tau xy, tau xz. Here actually I have to write tau yx, but tau yx and tau xy are same, right? Again, I will write tau xy, sigma y. Here I have to write tau yz, okay? Here again, tau, I have to write here zx, but zx is same as xz, right? So xz. Again, here I have to write zy, but zy is same as yz, right? I will write yz. Here ultimately sigma z. Now observe, isn't this a symmetric matrix? Right? So earlier we were talking about 9 stress components. Now magnitude wise, how many stress components we have? 1, 2, 3. Magnitude wise, this and this are same. So I will consider only 1. Again, this and this are same. So I will only consider 1. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and this are same. So I will consider this one. So total 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. These lower triangles anyway same as these values. so I need not consider them again. So total how many independent stress elements, not independent, different stress elements are there? Different stress elements. Six. And what are they? Ultimately, when I try to draw a column matrix, I have six elements. That is sigma x, sigma y, sigma z, sigma yz, sigma zx, sigma xy. So this is the stress matrix. So for now, stress matrix, a column matrix, when it is expressed in a column. Now in the next class, we will try to study same concepts, similar concepts, but quick way about strain system. This is stress system. We will talk about strain system. So that's all for this class. Thank you.